Greetings, Guardians. My name is Bife here. Let's talk about some more exotic weapon lore. This time, we're going to be taking a look at everybody's favorite fusion rifle, sniper, fallen weapon hybrid, the Queenbreaker's bow. To anybody not versed in the lore, this weapon will look like just another typical fallen wire rifle the snipers that Vandals are typically equipped with, and functionally they'd be correct in saying that. It holds all the same traits as the other weapons, firing a concentrated staple energy field of fusion-based arc energy to decimate a target at range. It holds the same small refinements that most wire rifles do, including a pair of scopes to match the extra set of eyes that the fallen have. It functions at long range like a sniper rifle, despite technically being a fusion rifle. But underneath all of the similar coats of paint and functions, it holds a weapon that is different because of the history it represents. To understand that history, we're gonna have to go back once again to the Battle of the Twilight Gap. I feel like I need a counter in the top right with the number of times that I've mentioned this battle, so you know what, screw it, let's start now, I'll catch it up later. Anyway, the Battle of the Twilight Gap was the largest attack in the city's history. The combined forces of the Fallen House of Devils, the House of Winter, and the House of Kings assaulted the city's walls in an attempt to retake the Great Machine, also known as the Traveler. However, commonly known is the fact that the Great Assault on the city was supposed to be joined by a fourth house, namely the House of Wolves. Their forces numbered in the millions and would easily have turned the tide of battle for the city. They were originally based in the Jovians and were en route to the Battle of the Twilight Gap, but stopped briefly at Ceres to restock, right in the middle of the territory of the Reefborn Awoken, now under the control of Mara Sov. The Queen beneath the Howling Dark saw the presence of the Fallen at her door, millions in number, and was presented with two choices that would ultimately shape the future of all three races, the Awoken, the Elixni, and humanity. She could either allow the Fallen to pass, which would have almost certainly meant the city's destruction, and that the Fallen would reclaim the Traveler. Alternatively, she could reveal herself, engage the Fallen Wolves, and potentially save the city. But in doing so, she would risk the lives of many Awoken and would ensure that the Reef was no longer a secret held close to their chest. Mara Sov decided to assault the Fallen House of Wolves. In the initial assault she made, she unleashed a superweapon that the Awoken had created, known as the Harbinger, which decimated the Fallen forces with the Void. The House of Wolves lost nearly half of its entire force that day, and in the process the asteroid of Ceres was destroyed. The casualties included the Wolf's Kell. As a result, the Wolves fought amongst themselves, and eventually Skolas the Rabid was nominated as new Kell by the fact that he had been able to either kill all of the other competition, or alternatively, all of it had been killed for him. However, there was conflict because normally there was a very clear line of succession for the Fallen when it came to their Kells. The one that is strongest should be the one to command the house, and therefore the one that kills the Kell should become the Kell. The Queen's murder of the Kell of Wolves meant that normally she would have become the one to command the house, but after all, she was an enemy, and the Fallen Wolves were not so quickly going to follow a Kell from another species, let alone one that had just declared war on them. The attack at Ceres would begin a long series of skirmishes and battles that is known today as the Reef Wars, and begins the 10th Age of the Myriad. The series of events here is rather long, and really it deserves its own in-depth video later. Suffice to say that after multiple defeats, Skolas was put on the back foot, and some of his ranks began to doubt his abilities, namely Varix, who had always been cautious of the aggression of the Kell. Varix of the House of Elders was one of the last remaining Fallen scholars and historians of the Elixni, and was well versed in the Fallen rites of succession. He knew that the Queen Mara Sov could technically not be barred from becoming the Kell of the House of Wolves. He approached the Queen and gave his word that he'd support her claim to the throne and try to sway the Fallen. At Cybele, Skolas was eventually captured by the forces of the Reefborn Awoken, and it was here that Varix instructed the Wolves that it would be better to be servants of the Queen who had been dubbed the rightful Kell. After all, better to serve loyally than to languish with Skolas in the Prison of Elders. When presented with this option, the Fallen House of Wolves, for the most part, joined, albeit with some reservations and hesitation. The first of those to join the ranks of the Queen was known as Savix. So unprecedented was this move that Savix was given a great honor and placed at the defense of the Queen on her right hand. Skolas was sentenced to a time of punishment in the Prison of Elders, but eventually was traded by the Queen. She traded him with the Nine, a mysterious and poorly understood group that resides out beyond the Jovians. The exchange freed some of the crows that had wandered too far into the Cauldron of Rhea, an area controlled by the Nine, it would appear. However, what Mara Sov did not anticipate was that Skolas would be released by the Nine and would be given a catch. He used this newfound freedom and turned to a fallen legend, the legend of the Kell of Kells, the one to which all would kneel and to whom the Great Machine would dub as its Great Leader. He sought to unite the houses of the fallen within the Sol system under the Wolf banner, and with this newfound purpose, he sent word to the Fallen of the Reef to rebel against Mara Sov, the False Kell. The uprising of the Fallen was swift and brutal. Many Awoken died in their efforts to save the Queen. Of all the fallen wolves to rise, Savix was the first, just as he had been the first to bend the knee. Conflict at this point was inevitable once again, and the fallen that had made the attempts on the Queen's life dubbed themselves the Queenbreakers, even though the Queen still stood. The Queenbreakers' bows are those weapons infamously used in the attempts on Mara Sov's life. Mara Sov's Royal Awoken Guard took most of these weapons as trophies after defeating the Assassins, and used them as a reminder that whilst so few Queensbreakers remained, the Queen herself still stood, in spite of their sacrifice. These weapons are therefore a living mockery of the House of Wolves and their petty rebellion against the throne beneath the Howling Dark, and above all, not only represent a storied history, but also some of the few found pieces of fallen technology that is still functional, which Guardians have been able to use. We first hear of the weapon when we defeat Skolas in the Prison of Elders. At the end of the Trial of the Wolf Kell, we claim the Elder Cipher from his body. It is, however, cracked and damaged. Varix identifies it, and understands that the cipher is broken, instructing us to bring it to him. He then tells us that we must use the Queen's cipher in order to repair it, and after doing this, we must unlock the cipher by defeating powerful champions within the Prison of Elders. According to Varix, the cipher will watch and will judge us. When we are worthy, it will unlock and allow us to control its functions. Kells are known to have Elder Ciphers, as they use these ciphers to control the flow of ether throughout a fallen house. This gives them their power, it gives them the right to rule, and as Varix would put it, Kells use ciphers to control the flow of ether. Archons and Barons take deep drafts, grow tall, and dregs with tiny sips stay small. Once we have ignited the cipher, it has acknowledged our power and prowess, and accepts our role as Kell. We then pass the cipher to Varix, and he allows us to choose one of three treasured weapons that the Reef collected from the Fallen, amongst which lies one of the coveted Queenbreaker's bows. That's kind of it for the lore of this exotic weapon. I hope you guys did enjoy. It's something slightly different, because the story of this weapon is not actually in how we find it, necessarily, it's more in actually the political history behind it. It's a weapon like the gun that shot Kennedy, in a certain sense. It's part of a storied history of espionage, attempted assassinations, and even more. This really is one of the more interesting weapons when it comes to the Fallen as well, because again, it is functional Fallen technology, but also, it's part of one of the more powerful houses' storied history, and also of how it was broken. And once again, there is the point to make that these weapons exist as a living mockery of the House of Wolves and the Queensbreakers, which did not in fact break the Queen with their bows. In fact, we hold their bows now, and despite their name, the Queenbreakers lie broken. Thank you very much for watching, guys. If you enjoyed this, please feel free to leave a like, and if you want more Destiny lore content as well as news and updates, the subscribe button is down below for you if you want email notifications to keep you guys up to date on every video that I make. You can also hit the bell next to subscribe in order to get those. And of course, a comment down below is vastly appreciated. Tell me what weapon you want me to talk about next. The exotic swords is one that we've had coming up for quite some time, but I could also very easily do lore on Dreg's Promise or the Jade Rabbit. But in the meantime, my name has been, my name is Bife. Prodacia ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.